A very good morning to all of you.
Today I'll be presenting a case of a 29-year-old female. She came to me with a disease duration of 6 weeks and acute onset of high-grade fever for 2 weeks. She had history of headache and myalgias. Progressively, she developed lower limb weakness. There was inability to walk and severe pain in the calf muscles. She denied any history of skin rashes, any photosensitivity or oral ulcers. There were no Sicca symptoms, any Raynaud's, no skin tightening, any dysphagia, puffy fingers. She did not have any preceding sore throat or UTI, no claudication pain, any abdominal pain, loose stools or blood in stools, no hematuria, oliguria, any dyspnea, chest pain, palpitations, any symptoms of inflammatory arthritis or inflammatory low back pain, oral or genital ulcers, no paresthesia as headache, and no recent drug, any travel exposure. Past medical history was insignificant. She was a non-smoker, no other habituations, no significant family history. She had recent hospitalization for about 2 weeks where she received ceftriaxone and doxycycline. So she was a wheelchair-bound girl suffering since 6 weeks, significant pallor, skin examination was normal, there were no lymph nodes, her vitals were stable, musculoskeletal examination, there were no tender and swollen joints, respiratory system was clear, cardiovascular and per abdomen were also normal. On CNS examination, her higher motor functions and cranial nerves were normal, gag reflex was present, extraocular movements were normal, no facial weakness, sensory examination was normal, her power was 5x5 in the upper limb, at the shoulder girdles, however, at the lower limb, at the hip girdles, the power was 3x5 and significant calf tenderness. However, there were no skin changes associated with the muscle tenderness. The knee and the ankle reflex were absent and the plantars were flexors. Her first evaluation showed significant anemia, a hemoglobin of 7.8. Total counts were around 18,630, predominantly neutrophilic, eosinophils normal, platelets were 2.96, peripheral smear was normal and showed normocytic normochromic anemia, retic count was 3% and MCV was 80. She had raised inflammatory markers, a very high ESR of 130, CRP of 115, and her initial urine evaluation showed a 2+ protein urea with no active sediments. The blood sugars were normal, kidney functions were normal, albumin was 2.9, the SGOT, SGPT surprisingly were normal, alkaline phosphatase was normal, and even the LDH and the CPK muscles with the significant lower limb weakness and muscle tenderness, we expected the muscle enzymes or the LDH to be high, which were normal. The serum ferritin was also normal. Calcium phosphorus were normal, thyroid and vitamin D functions were normal, initially evaluated for fever with dengue, Vidal, scrub typhus, stool, blood cultures, urine cultures, stool or cold blood, all the parameters were negative. On immunological profile, her ANA was 1:100 with the spindle fibers. ANA profiles were negative. Myositis profiles were negative. DSGNAs were negative. Complements were normal. Antiphospholipid antibodies negative. Vasculitis panels negative. ACE levels normal. So the radiological investigation to rule out infective endocarditis, 2D echo was normal. The arterial venous Doppler were also normal to rule out any deep vein thrombosis. The CT chest was normal and the CT abdomen showed a single splenic abscess or an infarct with mild hepatosplenomegaly. The nerve conduction study was normal. EMG repeated 3 times. The first EMG was normal. The second EMG we did at Ames and it showed fibrillation potentials at tibialis anterior and left peroneus longus. And the action potentials in the deltoid and the flexor digitorum indices were normal. However, they could not be generated in the tibialis anterior and the left peroneus longus, showing active denervation in the muscles. Her MRI calf was done. Although the enzymes were normal with her excruciating pain in the calf muscles, it showed a significant edema in the calf muscles, in the gastrocnemius and the soleus, as we can see. The posterior compartment of the thigh was extremely tender. She was unable to walk. Then we did her MRI thigh after the calf. The MRI thigh also showed muscle edema in the vastus lateralis and the medialis. Then we went ahead with the muscle biopsy, although the enzymes and the CPK, LDH all were coming normal. To our surprise, there was no significant inflammatory infiltrates in the perimysium and the endomysium. Only a single vessel showed fibrinoid necrosis with nuclear dust. The fascicular architecture was maintained. Patient had not received any type of oral steroids before coming to us that the biopsy came normal. So to summarize, this was an acute history. 6 weeks, the girl was bedridden with lower limb weakness, very high inflammatory markers, normal muscle enzymes, but muscle edemas and a positive EMG.
as she could not walk and they were very distressed, we put her on omnacotyl with methotrexate. Within 2 weeks, patient had a significant improvement. She started walking, her ESR fell down to 10, CRPs became normal, and hemoglobin at week 2 improved to 9.8. The first urine routine showed a 2+ proteinuria, and by week 3, we had the urine protein creatinine ratios, which were raised. So now she had a proteinuria of 0.72 gram, a 24-hour urinary protein of 0.8. Initially, had put her on methotrexate for 4 weeks, and then recently, since the proteinuria, we were evaluating whether we should do a renal biopsy because she's already since 4 weeks on oral steroids and there are no active sediments and not very high proteinuria to subject her to renal biopsy. So we have planned in case the proteinuria progresses, and she has recently since 1 week shifted on MMF. So the provisional diagnosis was initially very confusing because all the antibodies were coming negative. To consider it a viral myositis, CPK, LDH, everything was coming normal, but very high inflammatory markers. She was not even fitting into a connective tissue disease related myositis. Because for the splenic abscess, she was treated with ceftriaxone and doxycycline, but the splenic, it could be even an infarct. And so I thought the possibility whether it is a polyarthritis nodosa related myositis, which is a rare entity where PAN could present with just myositis, and there is significant literature on that, that patients with presented with a myositis like picture. The other possibility was a distal myopathy. So the neurology evaluation was done and distal myopathy was ruled out considering her raised ESR CRPs. And distal myopathy, like a Miyoshi myopathy, could present with significant calf tenderness. A significant calf tenderness in an adult patient, a distal myopathy, a limb girdle muscular dystrophy, where we needed dysferlin genetic test. Because the patient already improved, we did not want to subject her to a muscle frozen section biopsy because after 2 weeks of steroids only, she started walking. So a repeat biopsy and distal myopathy was less on the card. The other consideration is a paraneoplastic because all the antibodies are negative. However, the CT chest abdomen does not favor any type of malignancy. So myopathies presenting in adulthood, apart from muscular dystrophies, inflammatory myositis, metabolic myopathies, endocrine, toxic, all the possible considerations were kept for her. Infections like rickettsia, Coxsackie, influenza, however, we could not do further testing. But for that viral, usually CPKs are 5,000, 10,000 as we see for viral myositis. So there were a lot of oddities in her case. And till now, she continues to improve on MMF. It's her first week on MMF. I'm open to all other differential diagnoses for the case. And it's predominantly a clinical decision to put her on methotrexate and omnacotyl. And now MMF. Thank you so much.
What serum aldolase levels were done? Serum aldolase levels?
Aldolase levels initially were not done. After 4 weeks of steroid, I did do the aldolase level and it came normal. So I think initially aldolase, because cause factor was there, already so many antibodies analysis were done, vasculitis panels were done. But I think aldolase initially should have been done earlier at the beginning. But the MRI was significantly positive for a myositis. Thank you.
thanks to Dr. Pangati and his team for inviting me to the RA session. Chairpersons, it's very interesting, and I think Delhi Rheumatology is in good hands when Shisha is the chairperson for the Guru. Thank you, Divya. And I'm going to tell Rohini and Ashok and others that because you didn't learn properly, so I'm going to give you a talk on how to approach joint disease. So better be careful. Really, I am a bit depressed and disappointed, rather, that undergraduates and postgraduates are not there for whom this talk was meant. Because with all the senior rheumatologists sitting here, it is really not appropriate, but because it has been given to me, I'll talk about it. This is the first talk, I'm sure, Divya, you must be remembering, the first talk I gave you when you joined the fellowship. I have no disclosures for this talk. Rheumatology is a strongly clinical discipline, and it mainly depends upon pattern recognition. We are pattern recognizers, and that's why I think this is the last frontier to be won by the interventionists. We are still clinician, and rheumatology remains one of the last areas where clinical importance is still very high. 80% of the diagnosis is made by clinical history taking, physical examination, and looking at the pattern with which the disease presents. When a patient presents with joint disease, because undergraduates hardly ever are exposed to this, postgraduates in most of the major medical colleges, it's only a short note for their exam, and that's why, unless it is important for the exam, nobody really reads it. But what happens when they come in practice? Approximately 25 to 30% of patients will come complaining of some joint disease, and the only thing they at that stage feel, either turn the head other side or refer the case to some other doctor. This short lecture will help you. You need not worry about it if you just remember this. And I think in Souvenir, which has been published for this conference, has the detailed approach to joint disease. That may help you after you listen to my talk. When the patient comes with joint disease, try to quickly get the answer for three questions. Question number one, what is the duration of the joint disease? Second question, how many joints are affected? Patient will say, I have pain in my elbow, but don't rely on that. On examination, you may find 5 other joints that are affected. Patient is complaining only of the right elbow because that's the most painful. So there, you have to be cautious. And once you have known the duration of the disease and the number of affected joints, then the key question, which will always be the most important in history taking, physical examination and investigation, will be whether the patient's condition is or is it not inflammatory in nature. And that will decide how we approach the management. And that's why these three questions can help you further by this way. Duration. The watershed is 6 weeks or more than 6 weeks. Why? Because most of the less than 6 weeks duration, patient doesn't have that serious a problem to approach the doctor. These are non-specific aches and pains, sometimes viral, sometimes of unknown etiology. Most of them, they disappear by the time it is 6 weeks. And those that need urgent hospitalization, they are so severe, so dramatic, that the patient will reach at least an OPD, if not the emergency room. So 6 weeks is very useful. By the time the patient realizes that he has some problem in the joint that needs to be seen by an expert, it's more than 6 weeks in the majority. The number of affected joints, I will just say, polyarthritis more than one or single joint. We rheumatologists will like to further classify polyarthritis into a patient who has two, three, or four joints, and we call it oligo, but you need not worry. Single joint or more than one joint. That's what by history and then confirmed on examination. Now, with these two questions answered, the categories started to come in front of us. We have polyarthritis that could be chronic, more than 6 weeks. We have polyarthritis that's acute, less than 6 weeks. Patient comes with single joint involvement, chronic, more than 6 weeks. A single joint, very acute. You will usually see such cases in emergency room. In acute, within hours or days, there's one category, and within a few weeks, but less than six, is the second category. Then we come to the crucial, pivotal question, is it or is it not inflammatory in nature? The most important feature for making the diagnosis and understanding the pattern of the disease of joints. Detecting inflammation in the joint, you must be wondering, why so much hullabaloo about inflammation? A red hot, tender, swollen, and non-functional. Everyone knows, taught from early days in the clinical training in MBBS. It holds true, yes. It does hold true for acute arthritis. But you just heard me. More than 6 weeks, that's chronic. Chronic inflammatory arthritis, these points do not hold true. So if you rely on these points, you will miss the chronic inflammation in the joints. There are different clinical sets of questions that need to be answered to find out whether the disease is a chronic inflammatory disease in the joints. Recognizing inflammation in the joints, mainly clinical, 60 to 80% only on history taking. Some of it will come on examination. Now, in history, it's so important. Inactivity worsens the symptoms. It's the key, because those who have psychological problem, what happens to your joint pain, madam, when you start working? Oh, badh jata hai. Thank you, you can now go. I won't treat you. You don't have inflammatory disease. But when the patient says, I feel better the moment I go and take a bath, some movement, make breakfast for children, I feel better. Oh, that's red flag. Catch such a patient. This is serious. She may become crippled if you don't treat properly. And if not aggressively, she may die of heart attack due to premature atherosclerosis. So early morning stiffness, afternoon siesta, patient becomes stiff after getting up even in the afternoon, short siesta. In the evening, watching television, getting up becomes difficult, the body is all stiff. On the other hand, activity improves the symptoms. A gentle exercise like taking a shower is enough. Doing daily chores, difficulty in getting up, by some difficulty I reach the kitchen, but when I start doing work, I feel better. And that is typical of an inflammatory joint disease. Many people have asked, you keep on telling 60 to 80% clinical. Are there any papers? Only hardly 15 to 20% on examination. These are the papers. I have made them specially so that you can't read it. So you will have to come to me to get the references. Now, recognizing inflammation, constitutional symptoms, loss of weight, appetite, low-grade fever, feverish feeling, kamjori nahi, true thakan, ana taban is an Arabic word, everyone is taban. But that is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about true fatigue. I used to work 10 hours non-stop, and now, within half an hour, I feel like sitting down and taking a nap. That is fatigue, loss of weight, loss of strength, fatigue, weakness, fluctuating course spontaneously. Same patient, same doctor, same medicines. This week, doctor, I'm fine, thank you. Next week, don't know what happened. All my joints are aching. Spontaneous flares, typical of immunoinflammatory diseases. Typical. That's how immune system behaves. Now we come to the joint examination. Hardly 15% extra additional information comes from examining. Joint examination will show it is warm. It is soft swelling. But the other things, that it is tender to touch, etc., that can happen even in non-inflammatory. Now we come to the investigations. Look at that, alkaline phosphatase. Oxford textbook of rheumatology has been mentioning it, and I have a case. 50,000 rupees were spent in finding out the cause for that elevated LP, and the patient when came to me was like that, but nobody had looked at the hands. One of the corporate hospitals in Delhi, it's a true fact I'm telling you. She says, I have alkaline phosphatase, they were looking in bone and liver. I said, but not in the hands. It's inflammation, it's acute phase reactance. So you have high ESR, high CRP. Everyone will look at a low platelet level. We rheumatologists look at high platelet level because that's an acute phase reactance. It's one of them. So if the high platelet, there is inflammation, be careful. All these vasculitides and all inflammatory disease, high platelet count. Serum globulin polyclonal increase in globulin since ages we have known. But alkaline phosphatase, especially after the case was presented, remember, it's an acute phase reactant. The inflammation goes down, alkaline phosphatase comes down. And then there are two things that are low. A few things are high, two things are low. Hemoglobin becomes low, normocytic, normochromic anemia. And then the serum albumin. And serum albumin has some connotation with methotrexate. Because that's how we treat. That's the metformin in rheumatoid. Metformin in diabetes and methotrexate in rheumatic disease is the same. And methotrexate, if you have low serum albumin, be careful, it can cause some adverse effects. Rheumatoid factor and CCP, everyone will like to do. Well, if there is chronic inflammatory polyarthritis that's symmetrical in nature, you may like to do it, but that's optional. But doing ANA, you will really be caught in bad, bad mess if you do that. Choose wisely. Don't do ANA at that stage. Unless there are clear-cut indications to do this particular test. So, this slide, I would like all of you to keep with you throughout your life. It will help you if you are starting the career in rheumatology. Thus, inflammatory or non-inflammatory, polyarthritis, chronic, acute. Monoarthritis, chronic, acute. Chronic inflammation, polyarthritis. Inflammatory polyarthritis, which is inflammatory in nature. Monoarthritis, that is chronic, inflammatory in nature. Monoarthritis, acute, that's inflammatory in nature. And then, polyarthritis, chronic, but non-inflammatory. Polyarthritis, acute, non-inflammatory, and that, keep on guessing. What is that disease? Non-inflammatory, acute, polyarthritis. And I will ask the question once I go through this slide. Remember, please tell me what is that. So monoarthritis, chronic inflammatory, non-inflammatory. Monoarthritis, acute inflammatory, non-inflammatory. And some of the main diseases in these eight categories are mentioned there. Anybody? Polyarthritis, which is acute non-inflammatory. 16-year-old girl, I was working in Kuwait, was admitted in emergency at night. Professor is not called, so I was not called. The senior resident looked after. So I went there and I said, okay, there's nothing, she is normal. By then some investigations were also, everything is normal. So I asked in Arabic, you please translate, did she had a fight with her boyfriend? Yes, she was crying and she ran away. And now at night she had acute pain all over her body. So that is what acute polyarthritis, which is non-inflammatory in nature. Hysterical fibromyalgia type of presentation. Keep this slide, it will really help you because I make the whole joint disease approach very simple, only eight categories. One of them probably doesn't exist, we just discussed. Other seven, there are two or three causes in each, and you properly investigate them and treat them appropriately. What is the pattern of involvement if it is inflammatory, especially polyarthritis? Now in polyarthritis, even in the non-inflammatory, pattern helps you. And I'll give you some beautiful photographs of that. So patterns of inflammation or inflammatory polyarthritis, main clue to making the diagnosis. Only peripheral arthritis, mainly spinal with or without peripheral arthritis. Both upper and the lower segments of the body are affected. Mainly and primarily below waist, asymmetrical large joint affected. Only peripheral arthritis, both upper and lower segment. Symmetrical pattern, it will be rheumatoid and rheumatoid mimics. Peripheral arthritis, which is inflammatory in nature, both upper and lower segment of the body are affected, and it is asymmetrical, then psoriatic arthritis, and occasionally peripheral SPA can present like this. SPA is the name for spondyloarthritis. Remember, SPA is the second commonest inflammatory arthritis after rheumatoid arthritis. Primarily below waist asymmetrical large disease, that is absolutely classical spondyloarthritis, peripheral arthritis, which involve hip, knee, ankle, and feet joints, usually asymmetrical. Mainly spinal disease, but with or without peripheral disease, we call them primarily axial SPA. In the olden days, the name was ankylosing spondylitis. And I can give you a particular case where we could make a diagnosis of ankylosing spondylitis, but the patient did not have axial SPA. And that is for my senior ones. We will discuss that. How can that be? We have a case. Presentation with acute bilateral ankle arthritis, it is such a special thing that I thought I will mention it as a separate issue. In the month of, this is the time, February, March, April, some patients will be coming, younger people, male, female, equal distribution, with acute onset, within 6 weeks they will come to you with one ankle is swollen. But by the time you ask the question, and by the time they really realize that one ankle is swollen, they come to you and you examine, the other ankle is also inflamed. This disease was not very well described, and it was said sarcoid doesn't occur in India. But now we wrote 3 major papers. This is called acute sarcoid presentation, name Lofgren syndrome. Now, these are the patterns very quickly. Polyarthritis, some of them are inflammatory, some of them are non-inflammatory, and this is what it is. The first one, bilateral, symmetrical, upper and lower segment of the body involved, by history, physical examination and investigation, inflammatory in nature, rheumatoid arthritis. Inflammatory in nature, polyarthritis, upper and lower segment of the body affected, but distribution of joint involvement, asymmetrical, commonest, psoriatic arthritis. Back pain, buttock pain, below waist, asymmetrical, 2 knee, 1 ankle, 2 ankle, 1 knee, with heel pain, classical spondyloarthritis, peripheral arthritis. No inflammation, knee pain, neck pain, lower back pain, first metatarsophalangeal joint swelling and pain. Classical, elderly, I have all of that you can see. Osteoarthritis. Hand is a gold mine for us rheumatologists. Look at the distribution of the joints, bilateral, symmetrical. You don't show me that, please. I started late, so give me time, I will. Bilateral, symmetrical, wrist involvement, MCP and PIPs. On the other side, in the lower one, no involvement of the wrist, MCPs and DIPs. And the color is green. And the first corpometacarpal joint in the snuff box, very painful. Diagnosis, primary nodular osteoarthritis. This is quite clear, asymmetrical, Wrist is involved, nail is affected, asymmetrical joint involvement. Diagnosis?
Psoriatic
arthritis. Feet, it's lovely. The bun, which is a light red, is bilaterally symmetrical. That is? Rheumatoid. First metatarsophalangeal, deep red.
Gout.
At night, in emergency room, gout. They both first metatarsophalangeal joint, both sides, green in color,
osteoarthritis.
And the yellowish with the nail involvement,
psoriatic
arthritis. So that is what it is. You can see that. You got the points. Now, joint inflammation, what are the causes for inflammation? Most important cause, most common cause, immunoinflammation. For everyone else, every other specialty, inflammation is sepsis. For us, that's the last thing. Joints do not get infected. Joints never get infected unless you can give me a cause for infection. Otherwise, don't diagnose sepsis in the joint. Remember, you will have to tell me the patient has sepsis because of this underlying cause. Therefore, autoinflammation, autoinflammatory diseases, and autoinflammation or immunoinflammation is the cause of inflammation in 90% or plus patients. Crystal, in Western country, that's number one, but in India, that's number two. And sepsis doesn't occur unless there is a reason. Old joint disease persisting, even osteoarthritis or gout or rheumatoid or lupus, anything on top of that septic arthritis. Injury, many things, underlying joint abnormality, malnutrition. One lady I saw in All India Institute, I still remember, she had sepsis in three joints separately. She was lying in a corner, not eating. Her husband, her son was in Canada, never looked after her. I still remember that lady. And emaciated, so there was a cause for septic arthritis. Otherwise, don't diagnose sepsis. So we are now coming to the nearing the end. So the patient presents with chronic inflammatory polyarthritis that has symmetrical distribution of the joint involvement in the upper as well as the lower segment of the body, and therefore the diagnosis is rheumatoid arthritis. And these are the rheumatoid. Terrible disease, catch it early, treat it properly. Rheumatoid mimics, you can help the patient's diagnosis by just looking at the extra-articular features. Otherwise, they look exactly like rheumatoid. Till last week, I have been doing mistakes. They come to us, rheumatoid, and after 3 months, she shows some Miller rash or some proteinuria or something, and okay, so she's SLE. Let us see the second commonest before I give you the mimics. The second commonest disease, and Kapoor insisted, my colleague, that you better talk about it because somehow non-rheumatologists are not aware of this disease, which is the second commonest. And in my clinic nowadays, it is the most common disease. Rheumatoid comes number two. Because rheumatoid everyone knows and they are treating. But it's spondyloarthritis are being missed with these patients, and they are now coming to us, and I have the largest number of patients coming now are SPA. Spondyloarthritis, axial plus peripheral, they may present only with enthesitis, chest pain. Again, a corporate hospital took 60,000 rupees in investigating the cause of chest pain, not asking the heel pain which was also there in this young man of 32 years of age. And on detailed history, the patient had buttock pains as well. Because there are so many costochondral areas that become tender. And when the patient sneezes, coughs, or takes a deep breath, there is chest pain. And they start investigating for cardiac and lung problem for chest pain. Mainly enthesitis, that is the most difficult one. Persistent heel pain. And the patient is a young person. Nothing is helping. Consider this possibility. Many peripheral, mainly peripheral disease, if it occurs, it is below waist, asymmetrical, with enthesitis. That's the disease which is called SPA. And all of them come with ATT. Why? Because lower extremity, one of the knee was swollen. ATT was started by whom? You know, I won't name them. They started it, but by the time it was about 2 months, the second knee got affected. Also, you have now resistant tuberculosis. Now, this is going on and we feel so frustrated about it. Please take a good history of enthesitis, take a good history of dactylitis, eye involvement, loose motions, GI involvement, back involvement, buttock involvement, and you have the second commonest, spondyloarthritis. And here we have, on the left side, this is classical rheumatoid, which I give you as a stand, point against which you compare. On the right side is asymmetrical below waist arthritis with plenty of enthesial involvement, red dots all over. So this is spondyloarthritis, and here is a young boy, same story, knee was swollen, becomes better by some medicines, goes worse again, ATT was started, nothing was happening, came to us, we took the history, it is straightforward, uveitis, enthesitis, dactylitis, history of psoriasis in the family or inflammatory bowel disease in the family, and this young boy you treat accordingly. And here is another one with a stiff back, and one of the knees on the left knee, I think, is swollen, you can see that. No, sorry, right knee. Right knee is swollen, and it is a typical case of, not tuberculosis, please, the history is typical of SPA. That completes the second commonest disease, and now mimics, I will just show you the photographs. This is classical, asymmetrical, inflammatory upper and lower segment involvement, nails are affected, big patches of psoriasis. The first one, upper left, rash on the face, young girl with proteinuria, diagnosis, systemic lupus, the saddle nose with fluffy shadows in the lungs, GPA, bilateral potatoes in the hilum with a lupus pernio on the skin, that is Lofgren syndrome, dry mouth with a swollen parotid, Sjogren syndrome. And this huge, big, chalky deposits all over, being treated as rheumatoid arthritis for 25 years. A pathologist, senior pathologist, in one of the peripheral towns. When we said, this is something else, he said, no. Everyone has asked me, this is rheumatoid. Diagnosis? No. It is hanging out, gout. And here are the crystals. This is chronic inflammatory monoarthritis. You have no business of waiting. You just go and get the histopathology to prove the diagnosis. There is no other way. Chronic monoarthritis, which has been treated by so many people and not improving, get the biopsy going, and there is no excuse for not doing that. Classical tuberculosis. This one has come. We will be doing the biopsy very soon. Of course, they are night riders. They go to red light area and they get this, gonococcal, acute polyarthritis. A plea to all the physicians, surgeons, especially orthopedic surgeons, any inflammatory arthritis, please don't wait. Send them to us. The reason for that is this, with tongue in cheek. So we are like that, and they are like that. Sorry, but that's a fact. If it is not treated by rheumatologists, that's what happens. When it's treated by rheumatologists, she has voted, it seems. Yes, my wife's hand. Okay, no offense meant, really. Non-rheumatologists can be sometimes quite good. But anyway, in by and large, you know, there is a subject which treats plasters and broken bones, and they do some problems on this. Rheumatology, we do the following. You remember Lord Kelvin? He said, if you cannot measure it, you cannot improve it. So we measure the disease. We know how to measure. We treat the person, not the joint. Knee mein problem hai, operate kar do, sab theek ho jayega. Nothing becomes all right. Use the anchor drug. It is the metformin for rheumatologist, methotrexate in correct dose and dose schedule. prevent comorbidities, lung, cardiovascular, this is the most important, lung is the second one, osteoporosis and vaccines must be given. Please, rheumatology colleagues, I have seen some prescriptions, I was rather disappointed. Vaccines have not been given in them. This is not correct. We rheumatologists should not stay behind, and statins were not given. This is not really good. It must be done. Methotrexate is like metformin. The other drugs don't work even in the absence of methotrexate. Methotrexate is a different drug than methotrexate, which is used in cancer. This is outside my title, but aadat hai, buri aadat hai, chhod nahi sakte, bata ke rahenge. It does not cause ILD. Never say that. Never. Methotrexate does not cause ILD. Have you read the online, my write-up in Indian General Rheumatology this month? You read that and you will know you can improve ILD by proper dosing of the methotrexate. So take home lesson, categorize them quickly, duration, how many joints are affected, is it or is it not inflammatory in nature? Drug treatment is highly specialized. Refer such inflammatory cases to us so that we can stop the progression, prevent their heart attack and osteoporosis and the lung. Thank you so much. Clinical approach, hope makes sense. Very sorry I could.
It's a pleasure to hear from you. Thank you, sir. Are there any questions from the house?
There cannot be any questions. You cannot treat anyone with inflammatory arthritis without methotrexate, remember that.
It is true that we are seeing more and more of spondyloarthritis patients, especially axial disease. And that is primarily because the ease of getting an HRAP27 done.
Precisely,
and
you are right.
This is one of the major reasons that we are now realizing that it's nearly as common as rheumatoid.
Exactly. And ophthalmologists are really great people. They have been referring large number of cases to us. Uveitis as presentation.
Thank you, Professor Malviya, for delivering such a wonderful lecture.
Thank you.
You're the stalwart of rheumatology, and I have been so impatient to meet you one day. So I am from 1975 batch, but I have heard a lot about you. For the first 20 years, I practiced medicine, and then last 20 years, I practiced only acupuncture, and I studied acupuncture from Beijing University of Chinese Medicine, Beijing. And it is my pleasure to ask you a question, which I was always asking for the answer. I get so many patients who are RA factor positive in rheumatoid arthritis.
Please don't call it RA factor. There is nothing like RA factor. It is rheumatoid factor, RF.
Oh, RF factor. So they come to me diagnosed as RF factor, RF positive, and diagnosed by rheumatologists. They come to me many times. They are on the drugs, and I treat them by acupuncture, and many cases they become RF negative. Is it a myth or is it a fact?
I cannot answer. I strictly talk about the proven things, evidence-based.
Sir, it is evidence-based.
In the modern medicine, I have no clue about this branch of medicine.
I changed my stream from...
I'm just saying that I will not be able to answer this because...
No, I just want to ask you, can RF positive turn to RF negative?
I guess everything is possible.
Okay, then maybe that acupuncture is not working.
We didn't have this knowledge in the past, but now there are several papers that if you treat to target, over a period of time, the titer of both ACPA as well as rheumatoid factor, they start going down.
But my experience is normal within 2 months of treatment. Anyway, maybe acupuncture is working, maybe it is by chance.
Acupuncture pressure, I have no clue really.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So after that wonderful lecture, it's time to invite another stalwart, Dr. Ashok Kumar, on the dais for the talk on the management of RA with conventional DMARDs.
Thank you. Good morning. I've been asked to speak on use of DMARDs in management of rheumatoid arthritis. And by DMARDs, I mean conventional DMARDs, conventional disease modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. The present outlook of RA has really changed over the years. The disease can now be diagnosed at a very early, undifferentiated stage. The current classification criteria are highly sensitive, and now we have wide range of therapeutic agents available, and our goal of treatment today is remission. And these are the criteria which are already now 10 year old. However, it's not inappropriate to at least mention where the shift has taken place, that you give weightage to not only the number of joints, but also which joints, small versus large. You can have 2 to 10 large joints and get only a score of 1, and you have only 1 to 3 small joints and they get twice the weightage. Similarly, in serology, it is worthwhile noting that rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP are both given equal weightage. Either of them could be positive in high titer or low titer, and you give a different scoring. If both are positive, that doesn't get additional score. So any one of these. Similarly, the duration, if it is not 6 weeks, you lose only 1. So you can make the diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis with any duration of disease. Less than 6 weeks also is possible, because you need to score 6 out of 10. And those are finer details, and I don't think I'll have time to deal with those. And it is important to remember this list of mimics of rheumatoid arthritis. So you have chikungunya, you have certain viral arthritis, other than that, lupus, other connective tissue diseases, psoriatic arthritis, reactive arthritis, spondyloarthritis, as you just heard from Dr. Malviya, polyarticular gout, hypothyroidism, osteoarthritis of hands. So often you see patients being referred as cases of rheumatoid arthritis when actually it is osteoarthritis affecting the hands. And similarly, it's important to note that there have been advances in clinical assessment of Malviya just mentioned, you know, measurements. So you have now means of measuring rheumatoid arthritis. So you have scores like DAS-28, Simplified Disease Activity Index, Clinical Disease Activity Index, and others. Similarly, American College of Rheumatology gave these ACR-20, ACR-50, ACR-70 grades of response when you treat. You have a way of measuring the disability. You have this HAQ Disability Index. We also have an Indian version of this. Similarly, you have very nice radiographic scores. So this Vander-Heide modified sharp score is very well known. So the score ranges from 0 to 448. Basically takes into account the erosions and the joint space narrowing. Then you also have well-defined remission criteria these days, and the American College of Rheumatology accepts these two definitions. One, a Boolean-based definition, which looks at tender joint count, swollen joint count, CRP value, and patient global assessment. Now you can see that the remission definition can accept one tender joint, one swollen joint, and a CRP value of less than 1 milligram per deciliter or 10 milligrams per liter. And a patient global assessment of up to 1. But all these must be satisfied. You might say, oh, somebody has at least one swollen joint, one tender joint, but then the condition is the CRP should be less than 1. So this may look a little awkward, but actually this is true, that when you satisfy such stringent definition, patient is actually near remission. Then you also have an index-based definition of remission, and that is Simplified Disease Activity Index score less than 3.3. I will not go into details, but this is important to keep in mind. Now, coming to the topic proper, as I mentioned, there are so many options available now. And these pharmacological agents can be categorized into NSAIDs and analgesics, one group. Disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, where you have the conventional synthetic DMARDs, you have the biologicals, you have these small molecules, the third category that has got added. Strictly speaking, the small molecules or kinase inhibitors can be also categorized under conventional synthetic DMARDs because they are not biologics. They are synthesized molecules. Now, steroids are still kept under a separate category, although as we'll talk about, they also are disease modifying. Now, moving on to the conventional disease modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. Over the years, we have really obtained a long list of disease modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, but this color is actually changed now. Something has happened. But the right hand side, you know, okay, over here it is looking the way I desired. So these are almost outmoded now. Hardly anyone uses this. Although in the 80s, we used to really strongly recommend and use things like D-penicillamine and oral gold, injectable gold and whatnot, all full of side effects. So they have fallen by the side because of the unacceptable toxicity pattern. So literally speaking, it is the top four in this column which are the commonly used conventional disease modifying drugs. And these are, you can say, miscellaneous, which we use sometimes. When we talk of anti-malarial, it is hydroxychloroquine, not really chloroquine. Gone are those days when we used to prescribe chloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine is the drug because of its better toxicity profile. It's a slow drug, rarely used alone, rarely used as a monotherapy. So mainly adjunct role, but still it is not abundant, it is important. It does add value to the treatment. The dose is 400 milligram per day for 3 months and then you reduce it to 200 milligram. I often see prescriptions of, you know, patients taking 400 milligram forever, which is quite disturbing because then it can really cause toxicity which we want to avoid. Adverse drug reactions include rash, hyperpigmentation, pruritus, nausea, anorexia, retinopathy. If you are giving a combination of drugs to somebody and then he says that I have lost all appetite, I have got complete aversion, first suspect hydroxychloroquine. Sometimes it does cause this kind of side effect. Don't suspect methotrexate, that never causes. It is hydroxychloroquine that will cause complete anorexia. Now, the thing that is important about hydroxychloroquine is the ocular toxicity, because of which so many physicians will probably avoid prescribing it. Now, I just want to reiterate that the American Academy of Ophthalmology recommends maximum daily dose of 5 milligram per kilogram per day. And the risk of toxicity mentioned variably in different publications. So I'll just mention a few things. That up to 5 years, the risk is less than 1%. Up to 10 years, it is less than 2%. But it rises to almost 20% after 20 years. However, a recent study from the US, from Cleveland to be more specific, I've given the reference at the bottom. They looked at their data, and out of 2,867 patients who had taken hydroxychloroquine for a mean duration of 5.9 years, that is about 6 years, there were only 3 cases who developed HCQS retinopathy of significance. And these 3 had actually taken hydroxychloroquine for more than 18 years, but then they had no functional loss of vision. So that's interesting, that they had the evidence on retinal evaluation, but they had not yet lost vision. So basically it is reassuring that don't be obsessed with retinopathy. In the first 5 years, nothing happens. After that, annual eye checkup is recommended. Now, what are the tests for hydroxychloroquine retinopathy? The primary screening tests are standardized automated perimetry as opposed to manual. Now you have, you know, the machine does all this. and spectral domain optical coherence tomography. These are the two primary screening tests which are to be done annually. And it is said that in Asian patients, one should look beyond the central macula. The secondary screening tests include multifocal electroretinogram and fundus autofluorescence. Next, I move on to sulfasalazine. Now, interestingly, this is a drug which was specifically developed for rheumatoid arthritis by a Swedish rheumatologist, Professor Nana Schwartz, in the 1940s. It is started at a small dose and increased to 2 to 3 grams per day. The monitoring is simple, monthly complete blood count and liver enzymes for 3 months, and then once every 3 months. And once tolerated for 2 years, actually no further blood monitoring is needed. However, it's important that since it is a sulfa, you should keep in mind that don't prescribe it to somebody with a previous history of sulfa allergy, and also be vigilant about it at the earliest. If you have suspicion that the person has allergy, must withdraw it. Other important side effect is GI intolerance and oligospermia. Now, it's important to note that oligospermia is mentioned in textbooks as an uncommon side effect, something to the tune of 3 to 4%. Actually, one recent study, well, it's not very recent, this is 1981 actually, but anyway, it caught my attention because they found that out of 28 patients who were systematically looked into, 28 males, 18 had problems with sperm count, sperm motility, thereby actually contributing to infertility. So be very, very, careful about somebody who is young and you have prescribed sulfasalazine, and actually they are undergoing tests for infertility. And I mean, it is actually embarrassing that person comes back to you and tells that the gynecologist has said, you know, nothing wrong with the lady. This man has oligospermia, and that's why we should be aware of this, that this is not an infrequent problem. It is not rare at all. Methotrexate, I think all facts are very well known, and I really don't need to read what I've given on this slide. Practically everyone understands this. So the current doses are 15 to 25 milligrams per week. There is no doubt that parenteral route has better bioavailability. However, not everybody requires injections. Most patients will be able to absorb the required dose. And if you start with oral, you will end up giving injections to not more than 10-15% of patients. Most of them will be able to manage on oral. For the nausea, you have various options. And Dr. Malviya has popularized coffee to prevent nausea due to methotrexate. It does work, and many times it doesn't work, but it is worth a trial. If a patient is having intolerance to methotrexate, a cup of strong coffee before taking methotrexate, and maybe a while later also repeating it, does work for some patients. Now, methotrexate has several side effects, including stomatitis, oral ulcers, transaminitis. In the long run, a bit of hepatic fibrosis can occur, skin rash, infections. However, these may look scary, but we don't see them commonly. The liver risk factors are obesity, diabetes, and alcohol abuse. So you need to be observant on that and avoid where it appropriate. There are American College of Rheumatology guidelines on monitoring of methotrexate hepatotoxicity, which are well published. We'll talk about that. Methotrexate pneumonitis is rarely seen. It is a hypersensitivity pneumonitis. The reported incidence is 1 in 200. So once in a while you see, but then it happens generally in the first few weeks after starting methotrexate, or maybe a few months, but generally not beyond 6 months. Contraindications to methotrexate are very well known. I really don't need to mention here. Relative contraindication is renal impairment, but sometimes with mild renal impairment, we are able to use modified doses of methotrexate, but one has to be careful. What about hepatotoxicity monitoring? The liver enzymes and albumin should be monitored monthly for 3 months, and after that once in 2 to 3 months. If an abnormal test result is obtained, you should decrease the methotrexate dose and repeat the blood test in 2 to 4 weeks. If the level is more than twice the upper limit of normal, then it is good to withhold methotrexate for up to 2 weeks. If the enzymes remain elevated, look for other causes. Many times it is fatty liver, sometimes person may be actually suffering from a viral infection, and at other times it may be autoimmune hepatitis itself associated. So then it requires investigation. However, if no other cause is found and you suspect it is methotrexate only, then best is to withdraw it for good. But how common is methotrexate hepatotoxicity? Elevated transaminases are seen in about 20% of patients who are taking methotrexate. However, levels more than twice upper limit of normal are reported to vary from 1% to 13% in different studies. What about methotrexate-associated cirrhosis? Does it occur? Well, the current estimates are 2 in 5,000 after 10 years of use. So it's exceedingly uncommon, but it does occur. One should know that it does occur, but it's not common at all. But wherever you have suspicion, you can do appropriate investigations, but routine biopsies are not recommended. We don't recommend biopsies after, 1.5 gram has been administered or 2 grams has been administered. That is not the correct approach. What about folic acid supplementation? You might have seen prescriptions of rheumatologists. Somebody writes 5 milligram folic acid per week to be prescribed along with methotrexate. Somebody writes 1 tablet daily, 6 days in a week. So what is correct? What is the right thing to do? So this was sorted out by our colleague Varun Dheer from PGI Chandigarh in an elegant study, where he showed that whether you give 10 milligrams of folic acid per week or you give 30 milligrams per week, it doesn't make a difference. The two achieve the same outcome. Even the efficacy is not affected, and nor are the adverse effects any different. So you can use just 5 milligrams twice a week, but everybody uses his own regimen. What about leflunomide? Now this is, you can say, a cousin of methotrexate, came from oncology, didn't work there, and was adopted in rheumatology because it was useful for rheumatoid arthritis. It is an antimetabolite. The adverse reactions that it can cause are skin rashes, GI toxicity, liver toxicity, alopecia. Remember, sometimes patients come back with severe weight loss, and this is not very rare, up to 7%. I used to believe 5%, but this is 7% is from a study which I just found in the literature. So 5 to 7% people can lose up to 20 kilos in 3 months. So if that kind of thing is happening and person is scared, my God, I've got some malignancy and he's getting workup done, please hold on. Just withdraw your leflunomide and things will be fine. The dosage is 20 milligram daily. The caution to be used here is that it is best to avoid it in people contemplating pregnancy. So in women, just don't prescribe if they are planning pregnancy. The drawback with this drug is that it accumulates in the body, and you need an elimination protocol with cholestyramine, which is given for 11 days to get rid of it, because it just gets deposited in the system. So I've talked about negative things of leflunomide, but actually it's a wonderful drug. And the advantage with it is that it is nearly as effective as methotrexate. Although it doesn't have the flexibility of different dose, you can either give 20 or you can maybe reduce it to 10. But the important thing is, in kidney compromise, when the kidney function is poor, this is the only drug which will be useful. So you can use it in patients who have got CKD. Next, cyclosporine. So cyclosporine is the drug that gave us for the first time the understanding of what T cell is doing in rheumatoid inflammation. Cyclosporin monotherapy has a limited role in rheumatoid management, but it is safe in pregnancy. So when it is to be used for a short period, like in pregnancy, this can be given. Combination of cyclosporin with methotrexate is great. It is efficacious even for resistant cases of rheumatoid arthritis. And this is all published in the literature. You have to adopt a go low and go slow approach with regard to cyclosporin. Don't start maximum dose from day one. Start and build up the dose over some time. The risk of nephrotoxicity is low if you follow the guidelines strictly and monitor for any rise in creatinine. If there is more than 30% rise in the serum level of creatinine from baseline, that's an indication to withdraw it. Tacrolimus, another calcineurin inhibitor, is also a useful drug for disease modification in rheumatoid arthritis. At 3 milligrams per day, ACR20 rates of about 50% are achieved. Methotrexate plus tacrolimus combination is superior to monotherapy. Tacrolimus again is a drug that can be used safely in pregnancy. The adverse drug reactions which are common are GI and renal, which I just mentioned. So nephrotoxicity here also is an important side effect. Lastly, I come to this drug called Iguratimod or Mimod. This is the only brand that is available. It has just been introduced in India. Actually, it has been in use in Japan and China since 2012. But in India, it has been introduced only recently. I have had the chance to prescribe it to probably half a dozen patients only, and I still can't tell you any opinion on this because it requires time. But from my knowledge, I can say that it is supposed to be equivalent to sulfasalazine in terms of efficacy. So besides its disease-modifying effect, it is anabolic on the bone. So that's another advantage with this drug. It down-regulates several mediators like NF-kappa-B, IL-6, TNF-alpha, IL-17, COX-2. The dose is simple, 25 milligrams per day to start with, and then after a month, make it 25 milligram twice a day. Adverse drug reactions, nausea, headache, pruritus, transaminitis. Important thing is that it can be combined with methotrexate with advantage. So you have another option available now. What is the place of steroids? I'm just going to come to end of my talk. As I mentioned, steroids do possess disease modifying effects. Adverse effect profile, however, is unacceptable in the long term. Short-term use in early RA is recommended. You can use it up to 6 months. Generally, we use it for much shorter period because our disease-modifying drugs take over. So this is called bridge therapy. You're just bridging the gap when your other agents, which are slow, are taking effect. But intra-articular steroid injections are, of course, very popular, very commonly used, and they are effective. Systemic steroid has limited indications in rheumatoid arthritis, namely vasculitis, interstitial lung disease, serositis. Lastly, I come down to the latest recommendations from the American College of Rheumatology on the approach to use of disease-modifying drugs. The essence actually is, you know, these have not yet been published, but you can get an executive summary on the internet from the ACR site. So essentially, they are dividing approach to early rheumatoid, which is less than 6 months in duration, and established rheumatoid, which is either already more than 6 months or disease which satisfies our old criteria, 1987 criteria, not the current ACR Euler criteria. Now, for early rheumatoid arthritis, what they say is that a treat-to-target strategy is to be preferred. That means you have to have a target. What do you want to achieve? The target is either remission proper, as I mentioned the criteria, or at least low disease activity. So one of these two must be achieved. Rarely you may choose a different target because of force of circumstances, a patient is not able to tolerate any of the available drugs or maybe some other reasons, but those will be exceptional. Secondly, for a person who is naive to any disease modifying therapy and has early symptomatic disease, what ACR recommends is a monotherapy, preferably with methotrexate. So they are not saying that you start with combination right from beginning. Try first monotherapy with methotrexate rather than double or triple. And then if in this early disease person still has active disease despite methotrexate, then all options open up with no kind of order of preference. You can go for combination disease modifying drugs, conventional. You can combine with a TNF biologic, anti-TNF biologic, or you can use a non-TNF biologic, in no order of preference. Of course, in India, also because of the cost factors, we will first try conventional disease modifying drugs and only later go on to the biologics. Then, if suppose using all these options, patient still has active disease, use of steroids is